So we now move on to the most awaited panel discussion in today's webinar. Each leader in this panel has contributed to solving large-scale problems using technology. We will use this opportunity to understand their perspective on the rise of technology in governance across the country, the sectors that require open digital infrastructure, and how they plan to leverage the same to accelerate societal impact at speed and scale. First, we have Rakesh Kaul, partner PwC, with over 20 years of experience in serving clients in the government sector. Rakesh has been leading several big ticket technology transformation projects in India, working as a trusted advisor to the Indian government on digital and e-governance initiatives. Some of his notable experience includes leading the technology and process design for the Goods and Services Tax or GST portal in India, and the citizen sentiment and feedback gathering strategy for MyGov, a participative citizen collaboration platform, among others. Next, we have Lakshmi Prasad Putta, founder of Vasaar Labs. Prasad is a successful entrepreneur from the US. Before Vasaar Labs, he founded OAT Systems, a leading provider of RFID solutions, which was acquired by Checkpoint Systems, a NASDAQ-listed company. He started Vasaar Labs with a vision to deliver last-mile visibility and decision support systems in the water resources, agriculture, disaster management, and smart cities. Its work for the Water Resources Information Management System for Andhra Pradesh recently won 3 prizes in National Water Mission Awards 2019. I would also like to welcome Amarsh Chaturvedi, co-founder of Transurve, an award-winning technology company working on location intelligence, smart city solutions, and advanced data collection technology for data democratization. Transurve was incorporated with a vision to provide India-centric smart technology solutions for cities. Under his co-leadership, Transurve has implemented projects of national repute, such as the property rights to slum dwellers in Odisha, leveraging AI ML in revenue augmentation of cities, platform for fecal sludge management, etc. Last but not the least, we have our chair for the panel today, Deepti Dutt, Head Strategic Initiatives, Public Sector, AWS. With almost 21 years of experience, Deepti's current focus areas are smart infrastructure for cities, utilities, and transport, digital agriculture, and the GovStart program. Prior to AWS, Deepti has led smart city initiatives at Microsoft and IBM as well. In between her corporate jobs, Deepti has done a 3-year stint with the Unique Identification Authority of India, or the UIDAI, where she was part of the strategy team to roll out the Aadhaar project. Over to you, Deepti, for the panel discussion.
Thanks, Soumya. It's a privilege to be hosting this panel discussion. We have had very interesting conversations where we heard Viraj and Pramod and then Hiren and Abhishek talk about the value of open digital platform and how that contributes to citizen impact at scale, and what work eGov Foundation has been doing along with partners. So very, very timely discussion indeed. And I myself have had the pleasure of working with multiple open digital platform, Aadhaar being the first one. You know, I had the honor of privilege of designing the entire Aadhaar authentication system, building things from scratch there. And now we're at AWS, believe very strongly in open platforms, open data registry, and we work with our partners on rolling the solutions out at scale. The topic that we have for discussion, I actually look at it from 2 perspectives. The first part being, how do you create citizen impact at scale? And second is using open digital platform. So both topics are being very close to my heart, and I'm sure to the rest of the panel that we have. And the panel composition also, I think it's a very interesting one. We have Rakesh from PwC. As we all know, PwC being one of the biggest consultant, biggest advisor to Government of India. And PwC not just brings advisory experience, they also bring a lot of large scale implementation experience to table. We have Prasad, very well established ISV working in both urban and rural sector, open digital platform, many states that they have been working with. So again, very solid experience in implementation. And then we have Transserve Amersh, which is actually an early stage growth company, which actually represents the struggles, the challenges that startups face, the usage that startups make out of these emerging technologies, and what advantage it gives to them. So a very warm welcome to the rest of my panel, and thank you for joining, and thank you to the listeners also for joining in today. I'll do question answers to the panelists, I'll request that you also keep typing in your questions onto the chat window, on the Q&A window, and probably I'll take some questions if pertinent during the conversation, during the panel discussion itself, and later on we'll open the floor for about 10 minutes, for taking specific questions to specific speakers. So, having said that, Rakesh, let me start with you. You've been working, as Soumya said, over 20 years, both as advisor and SI to government. So on adoption of open digital platform in mission mode projects, what's been your experience, how government is adopting mission mode project, digital platforms in mission mode projects?
Hey, thank you, Dipti. And at the outset, let me convey that it is indeed my honor and pleasure to be here amongst all of you. And listening to Viraj, Dr. Pramod, Hiren, and others has been really wonderful. And as Dr. Pramod said, I think all of us, all digital government practitioners, have for us last couple of years or last 5-7 years have been extremely exciting and extremely satisfying with what India has achieved in terms of enabling reforms or through technology. So to answer your question, Dipti, you specifically asked about mission mode projects. So let me try and decouple it or bucket it into three categories. I think the first category is where the projects are conceptualized to an extent and implementation is underway. And for example, let's take the case of health. I recall a couple of years back, we were doing some work with health and we realized that there were more than 140 small, big applications within the ministry which were being used. And the large holistic program of tying all of that together or tying it to the outcomes to an extent was missing. And that is where I think the whole National Health Digital Blueprint came into place, which helped create a very highly comprehensive approach. And I think what it also achieved, and which is critical for open digital infrastructure to work, is to align the vision of various stakeholders within the government and outside the government. So I think the time spent for doing that, which was private ecosystem, within the government, getting all of those agencies and as a state and center together to align around common vision and then create something of that stature, of that size, so that one can achieve those benefits. So I think that's one area of example where we have seen where conceptualization has happened and implementation is underway. The second I think I would bring is where the projects are still being conceptualized. And I think that's where a lot of discussions, debates are happening around how to build infrastructure as was conveyed by Dr. Pramod, and not just look at point solutions, but look at how do we create infrastructure which enables an ecosystem to develop further on that ecosystem, on that infrastructure. So for example, being agriculture. Now, for a very long time in the past, we have seen that whether it is state government, central government, or a lot of NGOs, self-help groups, etc., have attempted to create the front end for these marketplaces for farmers to sell. Some initiatives around mandi board automation have happened in the past. So to some extent, there have been experiments or projects with respect to front end and back end, but the middle, which is where the operating and the business model sits, which enables the front end and back end to work in a way that outcomes are achieved, to an extent was missing in the agriculture domain. And I think that is where, while it is being conceptualized, again, we are seeing that similar to National Health Vision, a new agriculture stack is being discussed, where we are looking at things very differently. We are looking at creating, farmer registries. We are looking at creating produce registries. We are creating at various kinds of elements within the infrastructure so that they can enable a lot of startups, a lot of ecosystem to develop on top of it, rather than trying to create, you know, just the front end or portals where one can go and try and create and sell products. So very different approach we are seeing there. We are seeing similar approaches in the logistics sector or in the rural development. So there are these projects which are being conceived now very differently from the way they were conceived when the mission modes were being talked under National E-Governance Plan, which is about, you know, 8 to 10 years back. So the second bucket of projects fall under this, where this category is being discussed. And third, I would say, are those programs which were laggards. And all of a sudden, they have the potential to leapfrog. And one such MMP, I think, is Employment Exchange, is Ministry of Labor. I think for a very long time, a lot of attempt has been made to rejuvenate it, bring in a lot of technology, try and bridge the gap, try and enable how it can bridge the gap for employment. And all of a sudden, now that we see after COVID, there is this opportunity for audible.
Yes, you are.
There is something. Sorry. So now we see that all of a sudden, this department or this ministry has the potential to become, what the GPS did to the technology world. All of a sudden, if they are able to help us, tell us who is where, who is doing what location are they available, what skills do they have. All of a sudden, we'll be able to solve the issue of migrant workforce. We are able to solve the issue of finding where and helping them skill better for what they want to do. So all of a sudden, they can find a new way of creating a kind of an infrastructure which can be leveraged by the employers all across the country. So all of a sudden, we see a new kind of thinking which can emerge for all those MMPs which were laggards, but can find a new value in the whole system. So in nutshell, I think it is a great place to be today for all digital practitioners. Government is viewing open digital infrastructure more and more. I think the experiences with GSTN, Aadhaar, KYC, Diksha, and especially we did talk about Digit, the kind of impact it is making on the ground, and how easy, I mean, just think of what we just heard, that it was implemented in Punjab in 90 days. And about 8 years back, it took 90 days to prepare an RFP. And then it took a year to, you know, buy hardware and data center and all of those things. And then one would go to the application rollout. So yes, things have changed. Speed and agility is available. The right questions are being asked and answered. So I think it is a good time for all of us to make the change happen.
Very well said, Rakesh. And the areas that you highlighted, healthcare, agriculture, skilling and employment, I think these are all the areas that will actually have the population scale that Pramod mentioned in his talk. In all of them are population scale problems that we need to solve. And definitely, that's where digital platforms, open digital platforms, actually play a great role. So you're very well articulated that one. You know, Prasad, let me come to you. You've been working across urban-rural sector to use data-driven governance, and you talk about, you know, transparency and how do you ensure last mile delivery to citizen-government interactions. Can you share some examples on how open digital platforms are enabling the same? What use cases that you are seeing? Some example of some of the work that you have done in this regard. Prasad, you are on mute.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for having me part of the panel. I really appreciate all the presentations and the discussion today. I've been working with eGov, or my team has been working with eGov for the last 5 years, one of the first projects in AP. And I think it's actually very good and heartwarming to see where the technology and the systems have got to now, right? Just as a way of introduction, Deepthi, as Soumya said earlier, our focus really as a company is to enable customers to provide last mile visibility and then provide decision support systems on top of that. That's kind of most of the work we do comes into that, right? And the reason we picked that approach is fundamental philosophy that you cannot manage or improve anything unless you can measure and monitor it, right? That's a fundamental truth. I think lots of management consultants, I think Drucker said it, long back, but I think that's true. in most cases, and actually it's especially true in the government setup, right? When you have citizen and government interaction, that kind of transparency is very critical to ensure that the services are being delivered effectively, right? So just I'll give you a couple of examples, Deepthi. First example is, I think, the work that we have done along with eGov in AP, right? And then I'll give you a couple more examples on top of that. So when you actually go and look at a urban setup, right? So nowadays, more and more states, they're implementing an ERP system. They're going and doing a digitization of parcels and buildings as part of the Amrut program or one of these World Bank programs. Then you have your door-to-door survey going on to collect your assessment and population information, so on and so forth. Then they are doing drone surveys. You know, the number of activities that are actually going on in most urban setups. I think in the discussion earlier, lots of states were mentioned that way. So what we have, the way we actually got connected to the urban setting was in AP, where all this work actually was being done, right? But essentially what the government really wants is a system that can tie all these data sets together so they can actually easily make decisions in a more simple, transparent, effective way. That's kind of really where they got us involved in the process. So we actually collaborated very, very closely with the eGov team, right? We bought in the survey data, digital door numbering data, ERP data, all these data sources, GIS data, everything into one unified solution so that government can actually make effective decisions on where should I focus to make sure there's no property tax leakage. If I have a bill collector getting up today morning and traveling, you know, kind of his route, what's the most effective route to take to collect his tax revenues? Who are the most likely people to actually go and get my money today? So I think that's kind of the analytics we built on top of all this data so that the actually government can effectively use this data to improve their operation. That's number one. But then once we had that simple system, I think Hiran was showing that during his presentation, the unified portal that we have built, right? Then the next question the customer asked was, Prasad, actually fantastic that we actually done the survey, we done the digitization, all this is done. So that is a state as on today. What happens tomorrow? There's a new building that will come up tomorrow. There's a new encroachment that will come up tomorrow. There's something else that will happen tomorrow. What will happen tomorrow? How do I know that I'm actually collecting all my tax revenue as I should be collecting, not just today, but tomorrow and day after tomorrow, next year and next year and next year. So that's kind of the plan that they have, kind of the challenge that they threw at all of us, actually, in the slide which Hiran was talking about. So at that time, what we started looking at is, so we need to understand where new buildings are coming up, where new floors are coming up. If those buildings and those floors, do they actually have the permission to build or not? If they have permission, fantastic. If they have the permission, are they actually building as per the permission? If they don't have the permission, how do you basically get them to be compliant, pay the tax revenue? If they are actually encroachments, how do I basically make sure I take care of that, right? So at that point, we actually worked, at that point with Kanababu sir, who's a DMA there, to do a drone-based assessment to understand where new buildings, new floors, encroachment coming up automatically, so that can actually effectively be bought under the tax regime of the government. But as you can imagine, a drone-based survey is typically operationally fairly intensive job, especially in a big city, is an operationally intensive job. So when we actually went to other states, then the question that came up was, drone-based survey sounds fantastic, but we want to do it every month. I want to know what buildings came up every month. Can you tell me that we can actually do a drone-based survey every month? Give me the data, right? And is it cost-effective? So then the challenge that's thrown at us was, give me where new buildings are coming up every month, automatically by 15th of every month. So it's actually public. It's actually, we're doing it in Bhuneshwar, right, in Odisha. It's public information. So what we are doing there is we are actually using high resolution satellite imagery every month through a artificial intelligence algorithm. The system automatically classifies the imagery into buildings, roads, fallow, so on and so forth. And then says, here are the buildings that are actually in this month imagery. it checks against last couple of months imagery to say where the new buildings are coming up, and then checks against the permission to see if permission is there or not. If there's no permission, then it just sends a ward officer for validation, collection of evidence, so on and so forth. So it is so effective now, Deepthi. I'm actually amazed that when we actually went to the system, I thought, this, my God, this is politically going to be very challenging. It is actually so effective. In the last 6-7 months, our system raised about 266 alerts. 233 already been acted upon, and 110 already been resolved. Can you imagine that, right? So now nearly 40% of the encroachments already resolved, right? So it's been so effective. So the government decided that they want to involve citizen. They actually want to involve, because see, they are trying to be transparent in terms of where things are happening. So there's no need for them to, you know, kind of hide behind the, you know, kind of the technology. They said, we'll involve the citizen. So actually they took a full page ad in local newspaper, and we actually launched a mobile app where they asked the citizen to actually download the mobile app, and they can start reporting on the encroachment. They can start reporting on the things that are actually not going as per the plan. So it's been only about a month or so. So far about 40 citizen alerts came, and 13 of them resolved already. So again, this talks about how a problem that all of us know, Deepthi, right? If anybody on this panel and all people who are participating, listening to the panel, they will know these encroachments, these things are a real problem, especially in the nalas and the water bodies and so on. So it's a real problem. And by having a transparent technology will help address this problem in a much more politically acceptable way, because there's no hiding behind the data, right? Just a very, everything is open out there, right? So actually, if you probably tracking with the last Friday, I believe, Supreme Court has actually did a ruling where they have asked each state to actually set up a nodal agency to monitor and manage all the drains and water bodies so they're not encroached anymore. So whatever happened, so they want to make sure that things are not further, you know, deviating from where it needs to be. So I think having a system, you know, open data sets, having a open, you know, kind of visibility into what's happening, and having transparency to all the citizens will help drive responsibility and, you know, effectiveness of these solutions, right? In addition to that, you know, one more example, Deepthi, you know, if you have time, is I started my work, you know, as Swami was saying, building this AP water resource information management system, right? So before we start this thing, so right now you can log into the website apwaterrims.com. You will know the water status of the entire state of AP. There's no password, there's nothing. You can just transplant every citizen, so they know how water is being distributed, where rainfall is happening, which tanks have. Because of that, they're able to actually manage the water resources much more effectively than before. Because before, if you want to know how much water do I have in my reservoirs, a memo needs to go out 3 to 10 days for the data to come back. By the time everything is already, you know, kind of different. We'll talk about that in a follow-on question, Deepthi. I'll stop here, right? Good.
Yeah, so I think very well said. You know, I mean, if my key takeaways from what use cases you talked about was actually building intelligent decision support system and ushering in transparency to citizens using all the cutting edge technology that you talked about, from, you know, open digital platform to satellite images to drone and things like that. Another topic that you mentioned, you know, the initiative that's been recently launched and pretty close, I mean, I believe in that very strongly, that can we convert citizens into sensors, right? So citizens as sensors. You know, we have so much of population all over our country. So can't we use them, can't we give them mechanisms, apps, and kind of incentives where they, instead of, you know, installing sensors all over the place, can't we just convert our citizens into sensors? So I think if they're able to make headway into that and actually, you know, create those engagement platforms where citizens, they feel empowered and they feel encouraged to actually log city problems, I think that will be better than any cameras or anything else that we can put on our streets and on our roads. So very well taken point there. You know, Amash, let me come to you. While we all talk about last mile delivery, I read on your website that you talk about last meter intelligence. So that really, you know, struck a chord with me that, you know, from last mile, you're talking about last meter. And Transurf is born in era of open digital platform, open data, and everything latest, open, everything open that we talked about. So can you walk us through your journey and talk a little bit on what you really mean by last meter location intelligence?
Thanks, Sikti, and thanks to EGA Foundation for hosting this webinar and having me here. So essentially, when I trace Transurf's journey as a location intelligence solutions company, when we ventured out in the market, we realized that the existing location intelligence platforms were essentially not open digital platforms. They were proprietary enterprise-grade solutions. We like to call them black boxes. So essentially, these black boxes were quite prominently placed in the market across government segments. Most of the government users typically, if they wanted to leverage location intelligence, they could not, because these black boxes either required training and experience of using them, or if you needed to solve a particular problem, say the problem of solving property tax or revenue augmentation in a city, you would need to write lengthy RFPs essentially to sort of develop systems or customize these enterprise grade solutions suiting your requirements. And hence, this was essentially a gap that we at Transurf saw in the market, and we felt that there exists a need for a location intelligence platform, which typically would solve the basic need of solving problems of where, which typically plague most of these decision makers around the country, and more so in the government segment. If you talk about location intelligence solutions and why they are needed, essentially the reason is primarily that the kind of voluminous data being generated on a day-to-day scale, almost 80% of the data now carries a location. And this data could be in the form of various formats. It could be mobile generated location. You talked about citizens as sensors. So yes, so essentially a host of apps which are generating location integrated data in real time. And hence, it becomes very important to leverage both high resolution, ultra high resolution location data, as well as the coarse resolution location data, and churn that together to generate actionable intelligence. The primary reason of underutilization of location intelligence in so far, despite having significant ROI, has been multifold. The first reason was cost. Essentially, the existing platforms, they just didn't carry the cost of ownership. It also carried the cost of customization, expertise, etc. for a typical government user. And hence, usage of a location intelligence platform at scale actually did not happen the way it should have. Second reason was competence. So you would need to build a lot of competence in either A, using the platform, or deriving location insights, or B, to develop custom solutions on top of it. Actionable real-time insights were practically absent, and you know, there was a dearth of platforms which probably were not available for cities of all sizes. So for example, if I take a small town with a population of 50,000, if it would need to leverage a platform for augmenting property tax, it would not be able to afford it, because they would not have competence. They probably do not have an IT infrastructure in place, and hence a multitude of reasons by which they would not realize the true potential of a simple solution of a GIS-based property tax system, which otherwise should be an easy problem to solve. Couple of other reasons which essentially also point towards open data infrastructure. And most of, when we spoke to a lot of government agencies when we started, we found that some of these agencies got mired in the cobweb of proprietary data formats. So a lot of public good, the public data which was supposed to be in open formats, was unfortunately created in essentially was not able to be passed on to the citizens directly for their use. That was one primary reason. The other primary reason was also the sense of ownership in a government department to manage platforms or digital platforms within their existing setups. So hence, when TransServ came in, the whole idea of leveraging open digital platforms was one of the key thoughts that we have had. And when we ventured into the market, we always believed that we needed to disrupt this whole problem of proprietary data sets, proprietary formats, make data more accessible, make location insights more accessible, and help the government bodies leverage location data at scale.
Very great thing. And I was also reading on the website that you're actually using all these things for solving things like a pickle slash problem and all. So, you know, how you use really these locations, such intelligence, location intelligence to solve these kind of problems, like, you know, very much required in our country. I'm sure all of us are. You know, from this, let me move on to, we all have very interesting ideas and a lot of things that we can do. But we're also constrained by challenges that we face when we start working with government government entities and government projects, the scale of projects. So, Prasad, you have worked across wide range of government entities, multiple projects you have undergone, multiple life cycles, implementation life cycles you have undergone. What do you think are core challenges in getting governments to adopt and be successful in using open digital platforms?
Yeah, Aditi, I think that's a very good question. See, in most of the projects that we work on, Deepthi, what we end up doing is we bring lots of, because if you want to help make decisions, enable decision support systems, you need to bring all the data sets together into one unified format, right? So typically, for example, I take an example of AP Water Resource Information System. We got data from 18 different departments, both state as well as central government departments, in real time. When it's real time, as and when the data is available, we bring into the system to actually enable the state to make decisions better, right? So my experience working through this, the first year was hell. That's kind of how we learned how to actually work with the government. So I actually came from US, you know, I still have the mindset of, you know, you sign the contract, everybody's aligned, you have, you know, they'll support. So essentially what happened, what we learned is everybody's busy with their jobs. So they you're not their priority. They have their jobs, you know, they have 10,000 things they have to do on a daily basis. So what we learned working through these big customers is first step in any successful project is to deliver something. So what we, you know, so now what we go through is, even though we integrate with 16 departments, we say our core department, we first bring it online and deliver the first most impactful use case live. And then we get the most senior bureaucrat or the most senior politician. It could be a CM, minister, or chief secretary, or special CEO, or senior people to come inaugurate with all the stakeholder departments in place. If CM or the minister likes it, if CM likes it, game, set, match. Because every department would want to basically be part of the same platform because CM liked it, right? So that's kind of one key thing that we go through now, is to make sure the first use case is most impactful. Number two, it's live in 3 months. Number three, we get inaugurated. Then you take about 3 to 4 to 5 months more to get all the other departments integrated and live as and when those things happen, right? So that's actually a big learning that we had in the first couple of years of company Deepthi, where we felt unless we get everything together, we can't go live, and the goal never happens because departments are, you know, so that's number one. Number two, the other thing we learned is there's no shortcuts, right? In the sense that if somebody gives you data in Excel, you upload data, you know, that is the data as on today. A week from now, the data is no longer valid, right? So we actually go take the effort to make sure the data is integrated in a live, either from the website or API, whatever it is, live basis, so that data is not more than a month old, maximum month old, right? That's number two. Number two, in most cases, real time. In some, when I say month old, for example, Deepthi, right? When you talk about agricultural crops sowing data, you get the data only once a week. You not get it every day because the Department of Economic Statistics will give you data only once a week, right? So that basically is about a week old, right? So third thing is, as we get this data, for example, when we are going live with this water system, AP has about 38,650 tanks in the villages, irrigation tanks in the villages. So we want to know how much water is there in the tanks, because that actually is a significant part of the irrigation potential. So initially, you know, people said, you know, we'll give you a mobile app for the department user to enter the data. And, you know, like you said, right, you know, if you give it a citizen, you have 10,000 sensors or 10 lakh sensor. But if you get a department person, he may do it in the first month, but then other priorities take over, right? Because, you know, Swachh Bharat has a priority for him. So many priorities happen. So then what we decided, then what we started doing is, we started making things again automated through satellite, right? So take the whatever points that happen that will lead to having data discrepancy, we took those things out and tried to start making it more and more automated. That's the second part. So we try to make sure the data is more up to date and more, you know, near real time, so that actually decision making can be better. The third big risk we saw, Deepthi, again, my experience working with the Indian, governments is only about 5-6 years old. So I see now one political change happen in the last 5 years. So, but what I see is whenever there is a administrative or a political change that happens, there's always a risk. There's always a, you go through a rough patch, right? Because the new team or a new administration that comes in, new secretary or new engineering in chief, they need to understand, you know, if this is part of their priority or not, right? If it's not a part of their priority, then they move on and the system is left behind. Once it's not a priority anymore, then data doesn't basically get updated, right? So it basically becomes an issue, right? So what we have done to solve that problem is, again, there's no shortcuts there, right? First of all, you know, to mitigate those problems, first of all, you have to solve the important problem. If it's a good to have, you can pretty much be assured when there's a change, the good to have will go, you know, sideways. If it's a must have, then it will sustain itself, number one. Number two, there needs to be enough adoption, right? So for example, in AP Warrens, this year, we had 13.1, so as on today morning, we have 13.1 lakh users logging in, or not logging in, you know, getting onto the website and finding information about water on the website. So that actually is enough of a, you know, usage of the data in the state. AP is a small state, right? Enough of usage. So when the new administration, new secretary, they know the system actually is being used, is being consumed by enough people, that they sustain it, right? Number two is, you need to make sure it has gone to the grassroots level. It's not staying at the top tier, but has gone down to the AEs and DEs and so on and so forth. For example, the analytics that we have built, Deepthi, with eGov Foundation, that especially goes down to the ward level. So now the usage on that thing is so much, it's very hard to say we don't use it, right? So that basically becomes part of the daily working of the department. That becomes a very easy to sustain that type of thing. So I would say the type of things what we have learned, Deepthi, over the last 5 years to make sure that the first 6 months is a positive experience both for our team, also for the customer team, right? So make sure that they are basically getting the support they need, and then make sure that adoption is enough of a depth in there so that when things change, right, things are not kind of pushed on the side. So we have systems that push on the side because there are good to have systems. So we make sure the good to have is no longer part of the DNA of the company. No?
Sure, great. You know, Prasad. So basically what you're saying is start with the most impactful use case and build enough traction so that, you know, even if there's a regime change, it's a compelling case to continue. And I think that requires having an agile and a scalable platform that, you know, you can go build things one by one and not have a monolithic approach where everything has to come together. You know, Amarsh, let me come to you. You know, it's in government, we all know that getting the first project is most critical, most important. And once you do that, once you're proceeding, it's easier for you to pick up with more and more projects, right? So as an early stage company, what have been your key challenges in working with government How did you manage to get first couple of your government contracts, and what would be your advice to startups targeting this segment?
Sure. So Deepthi, essentially earlier as a startup and now as an MSME, typically the procurement bit is used to be a bit hard when it comes to getting or bagging government orders. Primarily the reason being the pre-qualification criteria, which used to be part of the RFPs, typical RFPs, usually were tough from a startup or an MSME perspective. However, there is a welcome change that has happened over the past few years, wherein the governments have started opening up to procurement from startups and MSMEs, and that is a pleasant change or shift that we have seen over the past few years as a company. So essentially, if we talk about the key procurement challenge, I would say that the challenge still remains to some extent. But yes, with the growing awareness of the revised procurement guidelines, which are typically floated by Government of India, things have started getting a bit easy. Another way by which we could, so essentially, if we talk about getting the first order, initially the first engagement with typical urban local bodies were at pilot or a POC kind of a stage, where I would like to echo Prasad. So essentially, the impact which we could demonstrate through a pilot or a POC would eventually translate into a larger order, and we were able to sort of complete or work on city-wide rollouts. The initial pilots when we started, we also saw this as a major challenge, wherein the governments or urban local bodies probably would not even want to go for that kind of pilot. So that problem was solved partly by identifying the government bodies or government customers who had these problems at much bigger scale than others. So for example, if we were looking at a property tax kind of a problem, revenue augmentation problem, we identified the ULBs which were struggling more than the others, and hence we were able to sell to them more easily and get the first POCs or pilots from them easily. The second way of dealing with that problem was also to innovate on the technology offering. So I'll give you an example on the property tax bit again. So typically when the governments were working on large scale GIS-based property tax or door-to-door surveys to map all these properties for assessments, we realized that, you know, if the governments actually carry out a comprehensive 100% coverage, most of the properties which already were properly assessed would be reassessed again. And hence there would be a repeat activity which probably the ULB could optimize. So essentially the idea was to leverage AI and ML to triangulate data sets from discrete sources, like say utility bills, data sets within the municipality, like say trade license, water and sewerage utilities, etc., to triangulate and find under-assessment and unassessment cases from a usage of the property perspective. So essentially, whether the property is used as a commercial unit or a residential unit, we were able to triangulate that using multitude of data sources by using machine learning algorithms. Similarly, leveraging satellite and drone images to find out the spatial under-assessment or unassessment cases were also one of the typical solutions that we were able to leverage for cities at scale. Now, what this yielded essentially was a smaller set, a subset of the properties which the cities would eventually go and to check in the field. Eventually. So you would not need to go to every doorstep to carry out a property tax assessment. You would need to go to a smaller set of 30%, 35% of those properties where carry out that assessment. So in a way, leveraging the location intelligence platform and also bringing in intelligence from modern algorithms would eventually solve that bigger challenge. So I would say change in government mindset and the innovation, process innovation, and how you attack the problem at hand is something that would help startups work with governments.
It's great to know that startups can work successfully with government, and I have seen a lot of examples, you know, with startups that I work with as well. Rakesh, let me come to you, you know, and I'll put you in a little bit of difficult spot. While we are seeing here, hearing more of private sector view of, you know, how, what challenges people face, organizations face in working with government. Since you're a close advisor to government, can you wear a government hat and talk about what challenges do you think government faces in working in the data technologies and open digital platforms and, you know, startups in this kind of thing? So what's your perspective from government side?
Well, thank you, Dipti. That's an interesting question for me to wear the government hand and respond to this. I think then I would first say my biggest challenge as a government person would be, can I clone Dr. Pramod and make at least 100 of them? It would solve a lot of our problems. But while that seems difficult, I think the second most difficult problem that we that typically government faces is they work in siloed. There is a lot of siloed working between departments, interdepartment, within the same department, different divisions that work. So I think how do we promote collaboration between the government departments and within the government departments to work, I think is the single most important challenge that we as government face. And I'll just give you 3 points on that. The first big challenge that we face is for us to become a part of, you know, open digital infrastructure or include a lot of that which is already existing. What requires us to is to change or the course that we have already taken. There are legacy systems, there are existing contracts and obligations we have with our vendors. So therefore, as a government, to even, you know, get a small code written to kind of integrate with another piece of infrastructure requires them to go through a change order, requires them to go through a price reasonability matrix and all of that. So even small changes, once the contract they have with certain vendors, takes a lot of time and hence delays a lot of process at the end. So our existing system, legacy systems, from a technology perspective, at times it is difficult to to integrate. At times it is commercially very difficult to integrate. So those challenges continue to remain with the government. The second, I think we did talk about this thing of data sharing. I think the whole mindset and the hindrance to share data. The live example, I think, being GSTN in itself. They are sitting on a gold mine. But I'm sure with all the precautions, with all the right measures, if that some kind of data in the best formats is being shared with the private sector, can make it very, very meaningful for the private sector to really use it. But at the end, that data which is sitting with them, which could be a lot of where, what kind of buying patterns exist, what kind of selling patterns exist, what is being procured from where. So a lot of insights can be generated from that, and shared with public. And that also brings me to the point that Prasad mentioned, that, you know, for AP, they are, you know, integrating or bringing in data from 17 different sources, creating certain insights. Well, that's a great point to begin. But is the department willing to share any of those insights with the Samaj and Sarkar, Samaj and Bazaar, as put out by this program? But are they willing to share any of that outside their own ecosystem for the startups like Amarsh to take care of and create innovative solutions on that? So the limited view of using analytics and insights to improve governance is just one part of it. But how do we move beyond the barrier of ensuring that we make this data or these insights available in a meaningful manner for the larger ecosystem to make use of? And that will be the real use of ODI in that sense. And the last and biggest challenge, I think, is the fundamental to making any ODI is bringing in standardization, complying with standards, and bringing interoperability, I think, is the foundation of any ODI infrastructure to work. And that is where we cannot have, you know, one kind of, you know, enterprise architecture, which says that this will bring interoperability across all these programs. We have to have a sectoral view. And when we get into the sectoral view, the challenges lie there. For example, in health, we know that SNOMED or HL7, et cetera, standards exist, but the challenge is in adoption. And therefore, one would have to work towards that to ensure that you really unlock the potential of digital health blueprint at some point in time. And similarly, for other sectoral work, we will either have to adapt, or evolve these standards so that eventually we are able to create interoperable infrastructure, which paves way for larger open digital infrastructure to work. So I think these would be the three key challenges which the government faces while thinking and designing the open digital infrastructure. And to build on my first point, I think these are complex conversations. So there is a lot of capacity building required at the end of the government to make a distinction between creating a point solution and creating a solution which enables others or nudges others to create on top of it. So it's a very different thought. It takes some time for somebody to digest and then start unbundling, as Dr. Pramod keeps talking about. So that to really internalize that thinking and create projects of that nature requires a lot of capacity building and understanding within the government. So I think those would be the three challenges.
Exactly. I think, you know, what we're actually saying is the journey that we are looking at. You know, we suddenly want to get there one fine day, the journey that we're already on. And in Amazon, what we say is we believe in fail fast, fail safe. You know, have mechanisms to be able to experiment quickly, try things out, and, you know, fail, you learn from that and you move on. And I think that's the kind of approach that we are seeing in a lot of the government large-scale projects also, especially with open digital platform coming in, things are becoming much more easier to adopt and change. You know, given that we're running short of time, so I actually had another interesting set of questions for all the panelists, but let me club that with some of the audience questions that we have as well. So, you know, let me pass on the first question to you. So we have an audience question which says, what are the top three sectors that really need open digital systems?
So, well, is that a question for me?
Amarsh. So essentially, the three sectors which I believe are craving for an open digital infrastructure would include the list of land records modernization as the first use case, because that in a way improves the overall ease of doing business in the country as well as improve the citizens' lives to a great extent. The second sector, which I believe would benefit a lot from an open data infrastructure, would be the agriculture sector, because when we work with governments typically who are looking for high frequency indicators from say post-COVID economic recovery or impact of welfare schemes in the villages, it's really difficult to measure these indicators if we do not have open digital infrastructure at the rural level at scale. And the third sector, which has already seen penetration of open digital infrastructure, is the urban sector, where platforms like Digit have made a huge impact. However, I believe that there are a host of new problems or a host of other older problems which have not seen digital solutions in the past. And one of the key problems would be the issue of sanitation, fecal sludge management, which is one of the gravest problems plaguing Indian cities, would definitely benefit from open digital infrastructure.
Thanks, Amarsh. Rakesh, I'll pass on the next set of questions to you. And these are two questions that I'll club for you. One question is, you know, are we already seeing network effects play out in Indian civic tech space? What challenges and opportunities could these hold for open digital ecosystems? You know, maybe you could club this with overall, what kind of changes that you're seeing in government mindset as the network effects playing out? And second question is, how financially sustainable is it to build digital solutions for social causes? Are open digital solutions helping in that?
I think both of these are very good questions. So I think the first question related to was, if I got that right, was about how are we scaling these open digital infrastructure programs for various government departments. So I think, as I said, this is more and more having witnessed the success that Dr. Pramod just talked about us, especially in the financial sector, how many people we have been able to get into the fold of banking sector, for what the data he presented from 17 to 80%. And, you know, we kind of achieving something in 6 years, which otherwise would have taken decades. I think that realization is available with the government. Government realizes that there are ways in which open digital infrastructure should be used, and the department should contribute in whichever manner they can create open digital infrastructure for others to create. But as subsequently Dipti said, that it is a journey, and for each department to realize and create that kind of impact, we will see as we go forward. But there are a lot of programs like digital, the digital locker, I think a great initiative, but the adoption has been limited for a few years. It took some time for the governments to realize the potential that the digital locker had in terms of providing public service delivery and improving the quality of service delivery. But more and more departments are taking care of that, and it is becoming more and more real. So I think, in nutshell, open digital infrastructure is the way to go for India, because the population we are talking of 1.3 billion people, we have to find ways in which one can scale very fast by making the ecosystem work for it. I don't think alone government or alone private can cater to that large need that we have here. Whether the same architectures will work for smaller countries may or may not be. But for India, I think the only way to scale and reach our goals is to strengthen these open digital infrastructure more and more in the projects that we deliver. And as regards sustainability, definitely yes, as the usage increases, there are efficiencies and which get into the working of the government. Productivity increases because of the lesser time that you spend on each of those things. There are newer roles that get created. For example, I recall for a reform that happened in income tax about 5-7 years back, which was about doing a CPC, which was a rule-based engine for. So the people who were actually just doing filling those forms and putting it into the registers got into scrutiny, though they started doing more meaningful work in that sense. So I believe that these open digital infrastructures definitely have sustainability by bringing in better productivity and efficiency within the working of the government as such.
Thanks, Rakesh. I think, as you said, that the ecosystem solves the problem, and that answers the networks effect question that the person had. It is a networks effect that actually leads to it, and we're seeing more and more API economy kind of an approach being adopted rather than monolithic architectures, right? So I think, I hope that answers the question. Prasad, I'll pass on the last question to, in interest of time, and I'm sorry to audience, you know, who have posed more questions, I'm not able to take up more of those. So Prasad, a question to you specifically that has come from audience is, have you seen states fundamentally change their modus operandi towards data collection and coordination systems and capacities in response to these intelligent analytics platform? Have these changes stuck over a period of time?
Yeah, it's a very good question, Dipti. It's a crux of, you know, if that is successful, if you can make that successful, everything else will work, right? So I think my answer to that comes, you know, in twofold, right? So in the first, you know, kind of ramp phase, there'll be hiccups, right? So we've seen, you know, data quality issues. We've seen a number of issues in the first ramp. The first ramp phase is typically about 12 months, right? Then I think once it basically starts, the person entering the data, if they start getting the value from the data, then the sustainability becomes more and more and more, right? But at the same time, what we also have seen is there are, I think Amresh has said this thing also in his conversation, there are also other data sets I think you need to bring in to ensure the quality of data. Because for example, I was giving an example of MITand, right? So we asked the department to enter data of how much water is in MI tank once every month. So first, you know, 1 year was difficult. Second year two and year three was pretty good. And then the lethargy just sets in. Okay, I've been entering the same thing, right? So then you start seeing the quality of data issues. So the moment we bring in the satellite data on top of that, right? And say, these are the areas where the data discrepancy is actually there, and then send it back to the user saying that, please check again. Then the quality actually went up, actually skyrocketed, because now people are knowing that actually somebody is actually using this information. Somebody actually is watching this information and making decisions based. So that basically helped us to ensure the quality of data sustained and actually improved, because now people know if I'm entering 50%, somebody's checking that 50% against something else. So I better enter the data, you know, if I'm entering data anyway, I better enter it right, right? So I think, but that actually is a long process, requires about a year or two of hard work to make sure the department is actually doing it. And as people are getting transferred and people are getting, you know, kind of retired and so on and so forth, there has to be a continuous process of capacity building to make sure the data, you know, collection stays on course.
Thanks so much. You know, we have already run out of time, but I really enjoyed this conversation. I hope the rest of the panelists and the audience enjoyed as much. My key takeaway from this entire session is that, you know, the role of bazaar to contribute to Sarkar and Samaj is more pertinent today than it ever was. And organizations like EGA Foundation with their open digital platform are actually playing a very critical role in facilitating this entire journey, this traction that is building up. Thanks so much, Viral, Chiren and team for doing that, for enabling the entire ecosystem, the entire marketplace to come together and actually solve citizen problems at scale. With this, I hand over to Soumya, and thanks everyone for listening in and give up valuable questions.